Big day out, 1996. The year of Porno for Pyros, The Jesus Lizard, Rancid, and Rage Against the Machine. It was the year Jabba propositioned Justine from Elastica.
I was meant to ask her out. That guy there said ask her out, but, you know, I thought that might be a bit much on camera. You know, do you want to go out?
And New Blood Regurgitator and Shehad made their big day out debuts. It was the year Perry Farrell let Jabba ask him a bonus question.
I didn't want to waste one saying, how you doing?
Okay.
And it was the year pop princess Kylie Minogue graced the stage with Nick Cave.
I'd like to invite now Miss Kylie Minogue to the morning scene.
But most importantly, it was the year Channel V joined the big day out.
It's the big day out, 96.
I'd like to say to all the people of Australia, kick me, I'm different.
Do you believe that because something is bigger, that it is necessarily better?
...1996 was the first year Channel V filmed at the big day out. Channel V, then known as Red, travelled with the festival to Sydney, Melbourne, Adelaide and Perth, shooting interviews with artists and selected live performances.
I really liked all the team too. That I think they're sincerely doing it because they love music. And it's just like you get the media footage, we get some profile, we hang out, we're all kind of, you know. The Channel V stuff has given us a great amount of documentation.
I guess then there was a real sense of anonymity. Like, we wandered around, there was a real novelty with people that there was a camera there, and there was actually, I think the big day out was a lot more of an alternative, independent kind of affair, so people were quite resistant to the idea of having a camera around.
Prior to the 1996 big day out, Sydney had been the host to another music festival, Somersault, which featured Sonic Youth, Foo Fighters and the Beastie Boys.
My memory's a bit hazy. I can remember my first real memories of the big day out are probably being in Adelaide, doing some burnouts on the way from the hotel to the venue, because it's very dusty in Adelaide at the showgrounds, and being asked to go and interview the Beastie Boys, and the producer going, all right, there they are, you've got to go and ambush them and talk to them. And this is Paul Fenwick, who now works on Fat Pizza.
The Beastie Boys are here. They're not actually here playing on the bill, so they must just be holidaying and checking out the scene, probably hanging out with Rancid. They all could do with a bit of a wash. Anyway, we tried to speak to them at Somersault, but we asked permission, and that got us in a lot of trouble. So this time, I'm just going to walk straight up to them and say, hi, how you doing?
And I go, we haven't got permission to go and interview them, and they're not even playing at the big day. They're here on holidays. You know, we can't talk to them. And he goes, no, just go and ambush them. Just the camera's on, guys. So I go up and I go, are you guys Ben Lee's manager?
Used to ride, didn't you?
Excuse me, are you Ben Lee's manager?
No, I'm not.
You're not? Do you have anything to do with him?
I can't talk about that right now.
Is there anything that you would like to talk about while we have you here?
No, nothing.
Would you like to tell us your name?
I got nothing to say. I can't say nothing on the comment. Thank you very much.
But this must be, we've been travelling you around the whole country trying to find you.
No.
Do you know, desperate to find you. I've bought shoes and stuff. You know, I've come looking and stuff. Steve, you know, can you tell us about this guy here?
I want to thank you for all your help. It's been really cool.
All right. Can I touch him too? Are you Ben Lee's manager?
Touch. No, I'm. He's my manager.
He's your manager. Because we were talking to him and he said he's been, you know, having a bit of problems with his management. So we shouldn't come to you and hassle you about him.
Exactly.
They go. They're a bit confused. We had like a 2-minute chat and then they're like, oh, we're gonna go and watch the Jesus Lizard. See you later.
I gotta go see the Jesus Lizard.
Oh right. Are you into kind of Christ?
Excuse me?
Are you into Christ?
I've never seen him play.
Uh-huh. And what about the Moist Boys? Have you got any goss on them?
I've seen them play.
You've seen them play?
They got a new album they made.
Is it going to be released in Australia?
I don't know if it's going to be released anywhere. It's, you know, pretty hardcore. You know, I got to talk to Ben Lee about it, though.
All right. We'll talk to Ben and send us a couple of copies. All right. Thanks. Well, there you go. I mean, how hard was that to cruise up to an internationally famous huge rock star and jam up? Don't know which one was which, but hey, that's life.
So that's kind of, you know, that's probably one of my earliest memories, and trying to crack onto Justine from Elastica.
All right, Justine, do you have any, I was meant to ask you out, that guy there said ask you out, but, you know, I thought that might be a bit much on camera, you know. Do you want to go out?
All right.
No, I was too chicken. I had a partner, you know, what could I say? It was all just show for the camera.
Oh, you know,
never forget 1996 Big Day Out when Rage Against the Machine played.
By the mid-90s, the boundaries of music genres were starting to blur, with the rise of artists such as the UK electronic rock group The Prodigy and politically charged US band Rage Against the Machine, who exploded onto the scene with their single Killing in the Name.
We played in Sydney and went and sat on the in the grandstand when it used to be at the showgrounds. Sat in the grandstand there and watched Rage Against the Machine, and when they played, you know, fuck you, I won't do what you tell me or whatever, the entire crowd was all jumping as one. It was the first time I'd ever seen it. It was phenomenal, really amazing. And Kylie Minogue was sitting right near us as well.
And it was just the most amazing thing that I've been involved in, and just and turning around and seeing the stands, all, it was like 50,000 people there that day, and just seeing everyone moving all at once, and everything was cool and everyone was great, and Zach De La Rocca was just angry, and it was just amazing to see someone so fearlessly upset.
When they walked on at 4 in the afternoon and just power, just absolute amazing passion and power, they were fantastic.
I think it showed what potential there is for when there is a group of people who have all got the same mentality, and it's not this kind of stupid, violent mob mentality. It was very much in that time when moshing was really big, and thankfully that's kind of died off a lot now, but everyone was doing the same thing, and it was really powerful. It's the same as if you hear a crowd singing along or whatever. When everybody's got the same idea, it's awesome. What big gigs are about, I think.
You do what they told you. Now you do what they told you.
Ran into Zach from Rage year and a half ago at a bar when it was a friend and stuff, and said, "Oh, Zach," you know, and he said, "Oh, this is Ken, does the Big Day." He said, "Oh, the Big Day Off." And I said to him, I said, "You're the asshole that stole Rancid's cranberry juice. And you busted the lock off their dressing room door." And I said, "That wasn't right." And he went, "Did we?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Gee, I'm really sorry about that."
1996 was a healthy year for Australian music. Radio Birdman, Dirty Three and Nick Cave continued to represent the Aussie contingent in style, while new kids on the block Regurgitator, Magic Dirt and Powderfinger were starting to make their mark on the music scene.
Oh, it was a massive rush. But we was pretty scared. I mean, playing outside is also completely different. It's a totally different atmosphere to, and during the day, you're used to being hidden away, kind of in a smoky place with lights and all that sort of stuff. So, yeah, actually, I think it's incumbent on you to perform more. And we weren't really very good at that stage, I think, because we were so new to having big crowds and stuff like that.
I'm sitting or lying in Nick Cave's coffin, and I dispute the fact that Mr. Cave would ever be able to fit into a coffin as small as this.
Do you love me?
Do you love me?
Do you love me?
Like I love you.
Nick Cave was a real revelation for me because I'd never been a huge fan of his. I appreciated him and all he's achieved, but until I saw him live, it was really theatrical. I just thought it was incredible. Out in the open air, and he's just sort of, you know, it's like he doesn't even walk. It's like he's like a South Park guy. He just sort of slides around the stage. It's like he's amazingly smooth. I just thought that was really beautiful performance. The music was fantastic.
We were told we weren't going to interview Nick Cave, so this is over in Perth. So we did all these pretend links. We got some uni students had dressed up his dressing room with coffins and hanging dolls and blood and all that kind of stuff. And he'd arrived at the day on site, chucked everything out of the dressing room. He didn't want the coffins in there. And so we kept mucking around with the coffin. I'd lie down in there and go, oh, you know, Nick Cave didn't want to talk to us.
In fact, when we came upon the coffin, it was actually filled with these small dolls, which apparently Nick tucked into earlier in the day.
And then eventually we tricked him into thinking it was a documentary for the Big Day Out. So he comes over and I'm interviewing, going, "So Nick, you know, you live in Rio near the Big Jesus. You know, is that cool? Is that like, you know, is that your favourite big thing?" And he goes, "Well, actually, it's in São Paulo, and it is pretty special. I suppose my favourite big thing is the big pie." And then he goes, What do you say? Say something like, you know, are these Queen? Are you going to ask me about any big things? And I don't mean big things like the big pie, but are you going to ask me any important questions? And I go, no, that's pretty much it. Let's wrap it up, Nick Cave. Thanks a lot. So I was, yeah, shitting myself.
You've presumably purged yourself of the, or of most of your murderous feelings with the Murder Ballads album. Is your...
I don't know about that, really.
No?
No. Well, I mean, I don't find that writing songs about things kind of exercises or purges anything, really.
Or performing them, maybe?
Well, not really. I mean, it's really kind of articulating what they're about so that I kind of understand it. So that I understand what things are about.
The one person that I was scared to go up to, without a doubt, was have to be Nick Cave. Nick Cave was the one. And he was walking around with a video camera the whole time on that tour. And pretty much everyone was scared to go up to him. I don't know, not necessarily scared, but like, oh, what do I say, you know? And he was kind of like the king. Everyone was like walking around, so.
Thank you. I'd like to invite now Miss Claire Renaud.
My first moment that I really fondly remember was from the Big Day Out in 1996, which I think was the first year that we worked with the Big Day Out. And I think it was also probably the only time Kylie Minogue's ever going to appear at the Big Day Out, though I could be wrong. And she had just released Where the Wild Roses Grow with Nick Cave. And she performed with him on the stage, which is like an amazing thing to see. And I think it was a real turning point in her career.
Kylie Minogue, there was a different story because she was backstage in Melbourne and I don't know, she's a sponge, she's very media friendly, not like Nick Cave, and I G'd her up about being in Street Fighter and Biodome and dreadful movies, and yeah, it was cool. It was the start of a long lasting relationship with Kylie.
That's my favourite interview of ever, Big Day Out.
Nick Cave, how long has that been brewing in the works? Is that something you thought about in the 80s, or just how did it eventuate?
It's been going for years, I think, Nick. Over the past few years. You probably should ask him, but...
Well, we will later.
Once you track him down.
Yeah.
He says he's written lots of songs for me, and he's thrown them out. I just asked him before, I said, so where are these songs? I'd like to hear them. And he said, oh, I threw them all out, but I'd like to write new ones. I think he was looking for the perfect song, and that came in the form of Where the Wild Roses Grow.
And he remember he kept the photo of her short head period in his wallet for 10 years after that.
Yeah, I did. I don't know where that photo is, a little screen grab of her going, and I guess Kylie Minogue thinks I'm funny. So it's there, the proof is there, it's probably been lost. Can we roll that footage now, me and Kylie, mates?
You know, I've always been like that. Da 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 da, stuck it, woman. Yeah, da 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 da. Sing, out, girl. And so it was really nice to do something different.
Kylie Minogue, I bow down before you. And Nick Cave, well, no comment.
Next on BDO XV 1996, Jabba wins Perry Farrell over, but gets banned from the festival.
Humphrey, the Big Day Out 96 certainly seemed to be a bit of a narcotics tour. We've got Nick Cave in there, we've got Rancid, God knows what they're on, and we've also got Porno for Pyros, Perry Farrell, and of course we've got Tism, who are on the drugs that killed River Phoenix. What exactly were the drugs that killed River?
Well, I'm led to believe that River Phoenix was a big fan of Tarzan's grip. Now, you know, Tarzan's grip only works well in certain situations. You know, if you're looking to sort of adhere plastic to plastic, you know, Tarzan's grip is not your choice.
You know, that old theory of live fast and die young, I don't think applies anymore in my mind. I think that wisdom is one of the greatest things, I mean, if not the greatest thing, there's wisdom, there's strength, and there's beauty.
The 1996 Big Day Out was headlined by Porno for Pyros, the new project from Jane's Addiction's frontman, Perry Farrell.
I have with me a very special guest who says he'll only answer
three questions, Mr. Perry Farrell.
For the moment.
For the moment.
Yeah, just for the moment.
I didn't want to waste one saying how you doing.
Ah, okay, I'll do four. I'm doing really well today. How about yourself?
I'm not bad. I've spent a lot of time waiting around to talk to people like you.
That was a great interview. We actually got barred by the whole Big Day Out tour after that because I asked Perry the drugs question. You know, I go, you know, do you still do drugs? He's like, well, man, it's a party. If people are partying and they're drinking tea, we're going to drink tea. And he like rambled for 20 minutes. Great interview.
I am getting a lot wiser.
And would that have anything to do with not using drugs anymore?
Well, I don't know what you mean by drugs. I have slowed down on, the harder drugs like cocaine and heroin for two good reasons. One, it hurts my body, and it started to shortchange my creativity. But for the main reason that I have stopped is because I want to stop the curse that goes along with the coke that goes into the poor neighborhoods that are in my country. I believe the politicians understand how to suppress the masses through the uses of opiums and cocaine and alcohol. And that's one of the main ways that they keep you from thinking.
I smoked bongs with Perry Farrell once. Backstage, and he told me about the chakras. You know, I was like, I had a bong. He's like, you gotta understand the chakras. The chakra here, here, and here, and here. And they're all centers of power. Power. He was really amazing guy to talk to. He's really like, he is one of my all time favorite lead singers. Fantastic voice. And I just felt myself being mesmerized by his talking about these chakras.
In terms of front men around the world and all the guys that have been in bands over the years, you're kind of, you know, one of the freakier ones. And I've been thinking, what do I ask you when I get in front of you? And I want to know, at what age did you realize that you could perhaps live and be a bit of a weirdo?
Oh, well, what
did
age?
Did you undergo a change?
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm undergoing changes every day, and it's very exciting to always have something just ahead of you to reach for. It gives you a reason to wake up and sing in the morning, so to speak. You know, birds understand that. They understand that. You can tell they wake up and the first thing they do is sing.
But then I've got the drummer from Porno for Pyros, who I don't know if is the drummer for Jane's Addiction or not. I don't know. But he's this like classic drum shop LA drummer guy. Nice guy. Spent far too much time in drum shops. I don't know what you guys are doing, and you drum shop guys, man. It's like dippity dip, dippity tap. He's got a pack of this, pair of sticks in his back pocket. He's tappity tap, tap, tapping on my shoulder. He's tappity tap, tap, tapping on the bloody, you know, on the bong, someone's beer. He's tappity tap, tap, tapping, and all he wants to talk about is drums to me. What kind of drummers you use, man? What kind of drum? I don't know. It's for whatever set up. I don't care. You know, I'm talking about chakras here, man. Chakras. I don't talk about drums.
I did a photo session with Porno for Pyros, which is an experience in itself. First of all, Perry said to me, for us to work together, we have to have some sort of, like, trust. So I said, fine, yeah, no problem at all. So he made me close my eyes. I'm sat down on my studio in Canvas, and he's next to me. I closed my eyes for about 10 seconds, opened them up, nothing had happened. He went, where's the trust? Where's the trust? And I went, what do you mean, where's the trust? And he went, close your eyes again. I closed my eyes again. This time he grabbed hold of my bollocks and dick and gave them a damn fine squeeze, which is like, you know, whoa! Anyway, apparently after that we had a lot of trust. But anyway, so I'm doing a Porno for Pyros photo shoot, to be fair, I may have been a little bit drunk, and I left my gear in the studio, which is backstage next to the dressing rooms, and I go off into with Nick Cave's dressing room to have a drink with Howard Freeman, and I came out and all my gear had been stolen, which is pretty awful sensation. And cut a very, very long story short, 2 weeks later, a girl rang me and dobbed the guy in who nicked it. They came out and gave me all my gear back. In the meantime, the bands have taken so much sympathy for me. Nick and Kylie Minogue give me a free photo session to sell to get. So it ended up working out for the best anyway. But it was like, I call that instant karma. It was like really nice of the girl to dob the guy and then I finally got my gear back. But meeting Perry Farrell is definitely a experience. He also told me how he wanted to put out his own Big Day Out in a rainforest with no electricity and have everyone sat down in a triangle on trestle tables for sit-down dinner, and they were going to bring, and the light show would be provided by UFOs. His tour manager then turned to me and said, "You may well laugh, but he means it. I have to organize it." Perry Farrell, not the most normal human being.
I think it would be very interesting if people honored things that were small and imploding, you know? Well, I guess I understand why everybody loves things that are big and expanding, because the universe is expanding.
Still to come on BDO XV, things heat up backstage at the Big Day Out as the bands get competitive.
The whole tour thing, 650 shows, that's a lot of shows. And you're travelling with the Big Day Out. Does, you know, travelling ever get a bit much? What are your kind of Boise things that you do when you travel to keep the rock element there? You know, staying in five-star hotels and stuff, it gets a bit...
Tell him.
Well, we wrestle when we have a chance, before we go to bed at night, to kind of unleash all the other toxins and the tension and our torsos. It's a tea thing.
Since taking to the road in 1993, the Big Day Out has been fondly referred to as the Big Day Off by many artists.
Working holidays. You know, how much hard work do you do when you're out here? Do you wake up every day and go, "We've got to play today. Wow, what a bummer."
Okay.
I don't think we play enough, you know. It needs to be. Australia's so much slower. You know, every time we've been, there's always like big, massive days off. It doesn't seem to have a flow to it. You know, we tour Europe and it's always more hectic, but it seems to be, it's not, you know, it's not about having sort of fun in, you know, it's about enjoying, fun in the sun. It's enjoying, we enjoy doing the shows, and that's why we're here, so we like to just get on with it.
There's definitely a big day off element about it, and I know a lot of overseas bands have talked about that they get the opportunity to just hoon.
Just the whole tour, it goes for 2 weeks, and there's only 6 gigs or something, and we used to do 5 gigs a week when we were touring then, or 6 maybe, so it was just a bludge. It was such a bludge, and we were just drunk the whole time. It was hot.
And I guess that helps for the festival, because particularly with the larger bands that do come out, they do seem to be enjoying themselves. They're very well sort of, you know, pampered and catered for. So when they've got that hour of the day to go and, you know, blew people away, and often they do. And it's, you know, you'd think that because it is an all-ages thing that younger kids will go and see bands really put in. And, you know, maybe they'll be encouraged to go and do the same thing themselves.
Mingle with the other rock stars on these tours?
Well, we'd really like to mingle, but everywhere we go there's a person at the door, usually this sort of really big muscly bald guy with a Zapata moustache, who says, "I'm sorry, you can't go there," and quite obviously he's worked out that we are in TISM and the rock world hates us. You know, that's for good reason. We're parading as a talented band, we're parading as interesting guys. We're parading as real on-the-edge rock music, and, you know, I guess the people on the Big Day Out are aware of the sort of sham that they've attached themselves to.
You're normally off stage the opposite of what you are on stage, because you're playing a role. So if you're playing a role, then theoretically you're not that thing, because otherwise how else do you go out in front of 50,000 people and do it? Because if you're just you, you're scared shit out. I mean, I'm scared enough when I go out just to say, can you, safety announcement or something, they're going, "Oh God, there's so many people. How do they do it? How do they remember to play things and stuff?" And it's quite funny, it's the ones that are lovely, the audience on stage, bastards off stage normally. I find that funny, because you get all those stories about the MOR acts and stuff like that. You know, that, you know, they're, "Oh, I love everybody. My rider's not ready, and I'm going to fire you." And all the beautiful people, you know, like, and the ones that go out, whether they're, you know, they really kind of go crazy on stage, you know, even Keith Flint from Potty to come off stage and go, "Would you like a cup of tea? I'm going to a cup of tea now," and, you know, going on stage, so, and it's just lovely, you know, opposites.
Backstage at 96 Big Day Out, sport once again played an integral role in artist relations.
So there's a lot of sport.
Cram tends to start them all.
We set up a soccer game one year with Billy Bragg, Elastica and Road Crew against the Australian bands, and we played out at Glebe, all got very drunk.
We played, like, Tony Mott was our goalkeeper, and there was a whole bunch of guys on our team. But Billy Bragg was their star player. But Billy Bragg was terrible. Absolutely terrible. Most unco guy. You know, he's a classic, you know, he was a really nice bloke, but he was such a bad player. And I don't know who won that year, but...
Yeah, it's another thing to do, and a you know, silly thing to do, because, you know, traditionally kind of musicians aren't the... unless you cram. Sporting, you know, prowess. Yeah, those kind of things happen. And they're just something different, you know, rather than sort of, you know, sit around, you know, try and score, just, you know, try and nick other people's cigarettes, talk about, you know, how's your tour going, how's your record company? You know, go out and play something, so a little light relief, you know. And, you know, try and injure them so they don't play better than you, you know.
Next time on BDO XV, we relive the glory of Soundgarden, Fear Factory, Supergrass and UMI at the 1997 Big Day Out.